like any other Monday, except that it's also International Women's Day. Of course, there are, you know, days when I struggle with this whole concept of having one day to celebrate the genius and the inventiveness of women, or just, you know, a particular community or people. But then I also think that maybe March 8th is one of many such days of 365 days when we have an extra opportunity to celebrate women's achievements and, you know, strive for gender parity. And importantly, I think, by calling out inequality. So on today's discussion, we're going to be doing that with three exceptional leaders from the world of technology, a sector that is traditionally not really seen as very women friendly. But of course, things are changing. And the women who've agreed to speak to us today, each of them, they represent that. They represent that change that is underway in technology, in STEM, and they are making sure that positive change continues to happen. So let me just quickly welcome everybody in before we get into the conversation. Lesley Salmon, Global CIO of the Kellogg Company, a champion of girls and women in IT. Lesley, welcome. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you, Bianca. It's great to be here with you today. So as Bianca says, I head up IT for the Kellogg Company, so global CIO. And, you know, I look forward to the day when we don't even have to have this conversation, Bianca. Not that it's just one day in the year, but it is just not a topic or a talking point at all, where equality rules the world, whether it's female or any other underrepresented function. So great to be here today. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Gill Wylie, she's Transformation Director at Lloyds Banking Group. She's a member of the Transformation Executive Team leading the digital and the mindset transformation at LBG. Gill, welcome. And I, just as we were chatting, it stood out to me that you said you now head a leadership team that has a 50-50 gender split, which is incredible. Congratulations on that.
Yeah, no problem. So hi, everyone. So I think I was, you can tell by my accent, I'm Irish, Northern Irish, actually. I can definitely say I was born lucky, because I've always had really diverse teams as my leadership team. I think, you know, you'll probably, as we go through the day, we'll chat about it more, I'm sure. But I absolutely love the difference that gender diversity brings. And I think, you know, we have all talked previously probably about diversity of thought as well, but you can achieve that through creating difference in your teams. And so I've thoroughly enjoyed that, and that's what I have today. So it's a great place to be in a tech environment.
Indeed, things are changing, and it's a great time to be in technology. Last but not the least, Stephanie Trautman, Chief Growth Officer of Wipro. Joins us to lead a massive charter, whether it is to drive growth, client centricity, new market momentum, you know, our sales process, our brand resilience. Stephanie, welcome to Wipro and welcome to this conversation. Thanks for your time.
Thank you, Bianca. I'm absolutely thrilled to be at Wipro and also thrilled to be here with all of you today. I have had the pleasure of building really incredible, diverse teams throughout my career, and I look forward to doing the same at Wipro.
And just as a, you know, before we kick off the conversation and sort of get your views in terms of what has changed, what needs to change, and what can be done to change that, and sort of try and move from dialogue to action and leave with some concrete steps that everybody listening in today can sort of take away from this conversation. Before we get into that, I have a special message from our CEO and Managing Director, Thierry Delaporte. He couldn't make it to this conversation live, but he was absolutely clear that he wants to, you know, sort of send in a message to support the cause of opportunity parity and equality and you know, representation from both genders. And so let's hear out his message first.
Hello, everyone. And hello, Gill, Lesley, Stephanie, Bianca. I'm afraid I could not join your discussion live, but I wanted to make sure I send in a message in support of the cause we represent here. Of course, International Women's Day is one of 365 such days in a year when we all experience and benefit from the ideas and efforts and ingenuity of women all around the world. But March 8th seems like a good opportunity to reflect and remark on the incredible work women do. In 2021, I think I speak for everyone when I say we have greater than thanks and more heartfelt praise to offer our female colleagues and contemporaries. As colleagues, managers, partners, as fathers or friends, men must respect and recognize that women have been at the front lines of this pandemic in every which way you look at it. This isn't about being a male champion for change. This is basic human decency, and it's the only right thing to do. The world has stared down remarkable challenges in the last 12 months, but each of us here have an opportunity to innovate and inspire a whole new world order, both at Wipro and at countless other businesses. Because the workplace of today requires understanding, leadership, fairness, and intelligence. You all exemplify those qualities and countless more. You are all women who not only lead the charge in fostering inclusivity, equality, and change, but who are also prepared to uplift everyone you lead. So thank you for that. I have great respect for your work, your ethics, and the leadership each of you bring. And today is a good day as any to say that out loud. At Wipro, my role has involved creating these positive changes and doing that has meant listening, learning, and breaking some old behaviors so we can give the right recognition, credit, growth opportunities, and equal pay to women. Our work is far from done, but we will not rest until we have leveled the playing field. For now, I leave you to your discussion, but thank you for agreeing to join us in this important conversation. Bianca, back to you.
Well, I'm going to pick up on that one point that Thierry made. And Lesley, let me come to you on that. You know, he talked about how we need a different kind of leadership in the and as well as politics. Leaders of the world have spent the last 12 to 13 odd months facing a real-time test, right? They've had to learn to lock down and unlock their businesses as well as that of their employees and their families, right? I personally think that there is a small set or a handful of women leaders who've emerged across the globe as benchmarks for what competent leadership today could look like. Do you think that this is that moment in history when perhaps we're going to let go of all these old archetypal, archetypes of leadership and adopt a more balanced motion of what leadership is and what should leadership look like in the post-pandemic world?
Yeah, Bianca, thank you for the question. You know, one of the things that I absolutely feel the whole COVID situation has done has really leveled the playing field, given that everybody in most of our companies, yeah, we've still got frontline workers who are out in our factories every day doing amazing things, and you know, the National Health Service and other medical professions, there's people on the front line. But the majority of us working in technology and executives in businesses are on a level playing field. We're all at home in our offices, family noise going on in the background. My dog was barking a moment ago. I'm not quite sure whether it came across on my microphone, but we've very much got a level playing field where everybody's voice is more equal than it ever has been before. We're all the same size on the screen. We all have a microphone that we can use. And in some of the collaboration tools, there's a hands up button. So, you know, if ever there's a time when you can't get your voice into a conversation, it's a little easier putting a hands up button on a digital platform than it was sitting in a meeting room, putting your hand up, feeling like you were at school. So just the mechanics of how we're operating now certainly has done a lot to level the playing field. For sure. the second thing that I would talk about is diversity in itself requires time, investment of time. So if you have a meeting with five people, all with the same thought profile, very, very easy to drive to a conclusion really quickly. I don't think it will be the best conclusion, but easy to drive to a common conclusion. Very little conflict, very little debate. This is the direction that we're all going in. As soon as we bring diversity of thought into that equation, so male, female, underrepresented areas, whether that's racial or LGBTQ community, you need more time to have that conversation. And I think the collaboration space that we have now has recognized the fact that to have everybody's voice heard, we do need to allow more time to get to a better result. It won't necessarily be the result we thought we were going to get to, but we get to a better result. So I think there's a few different elements that have happened over the last 12 months. And then the other thing that I found, certainly in Kellogg, I found is it's not just females at home that have needed more time and support for children, although I've got to say that that does still fall to females more than it does males. But I know in my team, I've got some of the males in my team whose wives, partners, family may work on the front line. So whether that's, you know, a health worker or a medical worker, and they've taken the challenge of being the primary homeschooler on. So they've walked a day in the shoes of what ordinarily in the past has been a woman's role. And I think there's very much more an appreciation of the emotional burden that historically has landed on female shoulders, even if physically it looks like we're all doing the same thing. So I think those three things that have happened during the pandemic definitely have made it a really good opportunity to grasp the moment and to make change permanent as we move forward.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you raise a very important point, Lesley, about working from home. And I wanted to come to Jill on this point, which is about whether or not the field has sort of been leveled in a way. I personally believe that it's tempting to think that work from home is a big equalizer for women. And to the point that Lesley also made, that in reality, maybe it isn't the case, because embedded assumptions about gender roles mean that the burden of care, whether it's childcare, schooling, elder care, all of that kind of falls on women. And I think permanent forward-looking solutions from the corporate world haven't been part of the discussions for the remote or hybrid workplace of tomorrow. Do you feel that companies are now willing to make real change and sort of recognize the impact that perhaps childcare has had on women's productivity and job progression?
I think corporate environments are definitely much more cognizant of it, and Lesley probably highlighted quite a few of the reasons why. There's no doubt in my mind that the mental well-being of staff, whether it has been male or female, or however you identify, has been affected by the pandemic. And so I do feel that the thing we've been able to shine a light or do a lot more for our colleagues. And part of that depends on the company. So I know certainly from Lloyds Banking Group, irrespective of you, how you identify, which gender you are, we definitely were highly considerate to people's caring responsibilities, 100%. And I know people in my team, they were splitting their days between, in the morning I'll do the homeschooling and my partner will do it in the afternoon. And many, many people, it felt like it bonded families so much more, actually, because it was companies were giving people the space and time to look after their families. So for me, actually, it helped amplify the whole who carries the mental load at home. And it became a more equal environment, although there's definitely research that says females carried more of it, but it was more balanced than normal. I think when we parachute ourselves into the future where we're going to have a hybrid environment, many of our companies and our company, definitely, we're looking at what is the configuration of the office. When do you need to go in? What is the work that you would go in for? I mean, people talk about collaboration a lot. You know, do we reconfigure the offices to be collaboration zones? How do we solve complex problems? Where do you do your deep work? You know, because that's a really big thing for us. I mean, how can we make sure that we can take the best of working from home as well as the best of the office and fuse them together. And I think that is a really complicated thing to solve because actually everyone has a very personal view of that. So if you like to drop your kids at school, if you're a dad who does that and you've really enjoyed that part of your life, will you really want to be getting up at 6 a.m. and, you know, leaving that to someone else? Or as a mom, do you want to leave it to someone else? I think there's it's going to be really quite challenging for everyone to manage through that hybrid environment. Of course, the way to do it is to experiment loads, not to make snap decisions, not for people like me to think I know what's best for everyone else. I think we have to experiment relentlessly to find out a configuration and a choice. I believe in choice in life. And if we can create more and more choice about when do we show up in the office, when do we use the Teams environments and how do we do that? And I loved, again, what Lesley was saying earlier around Teams. I personally have found that the reason that it seems to have leveled the playing field is because the Teams or the, you know, WebEx, whichever technique you use for your online meetings, but it allows a more respectful way of making a contribution. And so therefore that encourages, I'm pretty sure that we've got better answers out of many, many things because we're able to, as leaders, facilitate getting the voice of everyone heard. Whereas sometimes in a room in an office, in a big meeting room, you know, actually you can get drowned out pretty fast. But I think this is showing a much healthier contribution from the introverts, the extroverts, the men, the women, et cetera, et cetera. So how we replicate that, we're going to have to experiment loads to find a really good answer.
Let me, thanks very much, Jill, for that. Let me stay on that point you raised about collaboration and the hybrid working model of tomorrow. Stephanie, I think we're right now finding ourselves in a rather unique position, right? It's precipitated by this virus. And especially as managers, as leaders who are spearheading very large teams like you are, what does collaboration look like in this real and in this remote world where most of the workforce is distributed? People have been affected differently. People of different genders have sort of different expectations on them, both in terms of family as well as work. And how do we maintain connection and conversation at the workplace while ensuring that it is still inclusive and it is still a place, a virtual workplace where everybody feels their voice is heard?
Yeah, I think it's a conscious choice that you have to make in terms of how you bring your teams together and how you engage with your teams. And to your point, Bianca, you know, when you have such a large team that's distributed globally, that is quite a challenge. I think about the impact technology has had on women's lives in particular, where we could make more choices to be present in places we could not otherwise be. Many, many times I was sitting on a sideline of a field hockey game watching my daughter play with a conference call going on in my ear. And maybe I wasn't the most productive, but at least I could be present. Whereas, you know, 15 years ago, that wasn't even possible. And so I think technology can be a huge enabler. I think a lot of the tools that are out there, not only, you know, some of the ones we talked about or that Jill mentioned, but other tools to really help collaborate and bring ideas forward. I've used a lot of them to do surveys and to do whiteboarding and things like that in a collaborative environment. And so I think it's really important. But I also think as leaders, the biggest challenge I had was in creating connectivity between my team members and with my team. And I think we have to make it a conscious choice, not just in group settings, but also one-on-one. My favorite view from the pandemic was one of a young associate, his wife was on the front line. He was pitching to our team and all of a sudden I see a little hand go on one shoulder and a little face peek around his neck. And we all started laughing, but he never missed a beat. He just kept going. And so I think we have to give each other permission to be ourselves in whatever work environment we're in, to recognize that, you know, we need space to manage through this. and just to be more human and accepting of one another. And for me personally, it was being able to recognize the people that I could tell were really struggling and taking the extra 5 minutes that I might have spent in a taxi cab going from one place to another to instead reach out and connect with someone on a human level. And I think that's going to be required. I was amazed, though, in the first few days of the pandemic, my calendar was like half empty. I'm like, oh my gosh, what happened? And I realized just how much time I spent on planes, trains, and automobiles and standing at the coffee machine, and how much time during my day was truly spent in productive time. But within weeks, all of a sudden, it filled up again. And I was like, wait a minute, what happened? And so I think we have to be purposeful in the meetings that we do hold and the time that we do ask for people to spend at work and create space for them to manage other things in their lives. And I think for women in particular, that has always been a struggle. But I also think as women, we have to set those boundaries for ourselves. And I certainly have done that throughout my career where things were just non-negotiable. The first day of school, birthdays, it didn't matter what was going on, I was home with my kids. And so I think we have to, as leaders, we have to recognize it and create those moments. But as women, we also have to create those boundaries. And I've never had, and typically male leader tell me, no, I can't do that, or no, they won't respect that. So we have to have a voice in our own story as well.
So learn to say no. And as leaders, we have to learn to create those sort of frameworks and structures that people are able to say no. Okay, that's the great takeaway. Can I be a little provocative here? I want to come to you, Lesley, with this one. You know, I liked how Jill talked about the need to create choice. We should all have the choice, right? But we're all in for-profit businesses as well. So as a leader who's responsible for a large P&L, how should we even approach looking at creating flexibility and choice for our people so that they are most I would say productive, but while maintaining the health of the business that we are in charge of?
Yeah, Bianca, you know, that's a great question. So one of the things that we're working on in Kellogg post-pandemic, because that day will come, is a scheme called Locate for Your Day. And to Jill's point, there's going to be a lot of experimenting to find out what Locate for Your Day actually means. But we're taking a very strong stand that that doesn't mean everybody back to the way it was before, commuting every single day, you know, bums on seats sort of thing, is the only way to drive value. And we talked about this very thing. How do you make sure that we give flexibility whilst also retaining value? And for me, it is down to deliverables. You know, if you go back 18 months and said to executive boards in any big for-profit organizations across the world, every single one of your people are going to be working from home remotely, and your business is not going to miss a beat, assuming you're not in hospitality. They would not have believed it. They would not have believed, because, you know, the implicit trust isn't there that you put people at home where you can't see them, you can't touch and feel what they're doing every day. They possibly could still be as productive as they are in an office environment where I've got my eyes on them. Look what happened. Fast forward, it happened like that. Every period end close has happened flawlessly. Every sales call has still been executed. Every savings project has still been executed. So I think every single one of our work colleagues across all of our organization have demonstrated that they can be trusted even if they're not visible to the organization. So measuring people on deliverables, I think, is going to be a much bigger part of what we do moving forward. It doesn't matter that you don't see Mary or Fred at their desk at 7 a.m. every morning and 7 p.m. every evening, provided they're delivering the results. And in the past, I think presence, physical presence, has stood in the way of results, deliverables, you know, deliverable-based results really being what we drive a business from. So I think that's a big part. That's going to feature heavily, I think, in how we operate moving forward.
Absolutely. That's a fantastic point. And I wanted to come to Jill with a sort of similar question, which is essentially around post-COVID again, because I personally feel that after we're able to go back to life in how we've lived it before, right? I do have a feeling that we're almost all guaranteed to value quality of life very, very differently than before. What, Jill, do you think are those investments that forward-looking companies, all companies, should be willing to make to attract the best female talent that's available within each of the communities? And then what impact do you think the corporate world is willing or prepared to take to the bottom line to make that happen? Because you're going to have to make some upfront investments. You're going to have to, you know, sort of put in the time, something that was discussed a little earlier, that you have to put in the time to be able to make those changes. So perhaps you can share with us what's going on at LBG and the changes that you're bringing mm-hmm. about. And then Stephanie and Lesley, I'd love to hear from both of you as well in terms of what's being done specifically in your organizations.
Yeah, so I think our LBG, Lloyds Banking Group's been really active in financial services about declaring goals. Now, not everyone agrees with a target, so that's a debate for another day, or maybe even today, but we've been working towards targets. Now, we've reset the target for getting 50% of our senior colleagues as females. I think it's by 2025. So I think, great, let's go for that, because you have to start now, and then you have to be very deliberate and active in your campaign. So your question then becomes, well, what are the conditions of this company that I work in that need to be true in order to attract more and more females through the pipeline and also straight into the company at senior levels? And for me, there is a real investment in valuing difference. And we've been working with our culture chief around what is the culture that is really fantastic in Lloyds Banking Group. What is the How do we celebrate the levels of empathy, care, and consideration, as well as achieving all of those outcomes that are inherent in our natural productivity because we are happy at work? Now, there is a big word. So I think that big part of the investment is helping people be happy at work. And when you are happy and positive, productivity goes through the roof. And I definitely have worked quite a while ago, because I'm getting old now, in an environment where you had to be serious all the time. You know, you had to sort of show up and, you know, stroke your chin weirdly in some weird way to be taken seriously. I mean, what was all that about? Actually showing up and being passionate about your work, being really happy about learning, about new methods, about allowing real empathetic and care and consideration to be valued at the very highest level. I think that's the greatest investment that will attract such a voracious amount of female talent to the top tables.
And just as an extension of that comment, Jill, I have another comment coming in from Annette Lavelle. She says, it's not a question, but more a comment. As a Wiproite who's working on the Lloyds account, I have personally experienced Lloyds' exceptional care and consideration shown to their staff. So, you know, here's proof of the pudding, I guess.
That's lovely.
Thanks for that comment. Indeed. Lesley, can I come to you and sort of get a sense, the Kellogg sense on this?
Yeah, Bianca, you can. So in terms of statistics, very similar to Jill. So we've got a stated objective of, you know, manager plus being 50-50 by gender diversity by 2025. And then, you know, we've got a lot of processes in place to measure it. And it's not about the measuring. We have to measure it at the moment because it's not just going to happen. But what's the environment that we're creating around it to enable that and to attract females, underrepresented communities to our workplace? And we actually went so far, Bianca, during the pandemic to change our vision and purpose. So, which I think is, I mean, it's just words on a page, but that for me, they're so powerful words and they absolutely speak to our ED&I investment. So our vision is we want a good and just world where people are not just fed, but fulfilled. And we absolutely mean that in every single one of our colleagues across the world, as well as all of our consumers. And our purpose is to create better days and a place at the table for everyone through our trusted food brands. So when we talk about a place at the table for everybody, that transposes so well to equality and gender diversity in the workplace. And we really do live what we talk about every single day. So across my IT function, our mantra is one team stronger. So every single person is part of a team. It doesn't matter what their background or where in the world they are one team and one team stronger. And we're also very, very cognizant generally across our Kellogg organization. We've done an incredible job through the pandemic of caring for people's well-being, and I think we will keep a lot of that on moving forward. So we've done a lot more education around diversity and inclusion. We've taken time out for yoga classes and for mental health well-being, because whilst we've given up the rat race of the commute, to Stephanie's point earlier on, we've now joined a rat race where every single minute of every single day, if we're not careful, is filled with meetings. So how do we take control of our own diaries? And I think technology's got a part to play in that as well. How do we take control of our diary and use the collaboration tools to make sure we look after people's well-being as well? And then Bianca, I would just say one more thing, which I think has been will be an incredibly powerful outcome of the pandemic. And you referenced earlier that, you know, it still has traditionally been the burden, if you like, of the females to take the, you know, the childcare or the care of our elders and things like that. However, more of our white male colleagues have experienced what that feels like through the pandemic. And whether we like it or not, white male voices are louder and are listened more than any of the minorities. So I think having white male voices come out in support of how challenging it is to balance emotional and home emotion, work emotion, and that whole, you know, every aspect of people's lives, I think that will in itself be a powerful catalyst for change moving forward.
Yeah, absolutely. And I go back to the point that Thierry was making, that this isn't just about being a male champion of change. It's just the right thing to do. And everybody has to recognize the contribution that our peers and our contemporaries are making, irrespective of their gender, but especially because there are so many more expectations on women. Stephanie, give me your sense of how at Wipro, we are making some of these changes to keep in mind the flexibility that we're offering to women, you know, the well-being, their well-being and the ability to support them as they walk through a rather unprecedented time when, you know, we've all faced our own set of challenges. But is there a way to help alleviate some of that burden as we get back into a sort of hybrid work model?
Yeah, so I'll say a couple of things. I'm early in my journey with Wipro. I've only been here a few weeks. But what struck me immediately once my announcement came out and my email was activated was the number of women that reached out to me to welcome me to Wipro. And so I'm personally taking responsibility in reaching back out to them, at least to acknowledge their email, to set time up with them to talk. But I really think I have to lead by example. I mean, Wipro does have goals like a lot of other companies in terms of what we want from a diverse workforce, but I feel personally responsible and accountable for leading by example. And so as I start to build my global team, it will be diverse. It will reflect our clients and our global world that we live in. And it's not that way today. We probably have more work to do than a lot of other companies. And so I'm excited about that challenge. And to Jill's point, though, I don't want it to be this onerous thing. I want it to be exciting. And I think one of the reasons Thierry brought me to Wipro was because of the energy that I bring with the role. And so we have to make it exciting and fun. We have to make it part of our everyday decision-making, but it shouldn't be this heavy, burden of meeting numbers, because that, I think, is part of the challenge of setting goals, but it's also doing the hard work to figure out why women are opting out of the workforce or why they're overstressed when they're at work. And it's because of all the things that Lesley and Jill have mentioned. For me, I think a lot of it, both from a corporate perspective, but also in terms of, you know, what our governments can do, you know, childcare is probably one of the biggest crises we have in terms of women entering the workforce and staying in the workforce. And that's true of all socioeconomic backgrounds. And I was fortunate that I had a good job that allowed me to afford that. But, you know, my productivity as a career person over the past 25 plus years was directly correlated to the quality of childcare and the way that I felt my children were living their daily lives while I pursued my career. And I do think that's true of women and men. So I think that's one issue that we have to address. How do we create safe, impactful, affordable childcare for all families? And then I think in terms of what we do as an organization, we have to be purposeful in how we hire and how we promote. I read an article a long time ago, I think it was a Harvard Business Review article, that said, you know, men are promoted based on their potential and women are promoted based on their performance. And it struck me that all the women, as we've now started to look at equality more carefully, I think what's been so liberating for women is that they've been promoted based not just on their performance, which we're all, you know, we're hardworking, we all, you know, strive to achieve more, but that we are recognized for our leadership skills and the potential that we have to grow. And I think we have to look at this next generation of women and unlock the potential and bring them to the table and allow their voice to be heard. So that's going to be very much a part of what I'm thinking about as I start to build out my team and help Wipro transform, you know, globally to look more like the clients that we serve and the markets that we live in.
Good luck, Stephanie, and you have all our support on that. Just on the point you were making, I found an interesting comment that's coming from one of our viewers and our colleague, Rosie, who I have the privilege of calling a friend, hopefully. So Rosie says that women leaders, especially working mothers, often are seen to be limited and less strong in their availability in the professional social scene. So, you know, feeling compelled to choose between work-life balance over getting actively engaged in extracurricular activities such as weekly pub drinks or public speaking opportunities. And it does have a knock-on effect and certainly is a factor in their relatively slower career progression, which I think is an absolutely valid point that she's making. But I wanted to stay on the conversation about you know, building the next gen, because that is also a question that has come in from Yogesh Shivangi. But there are so few women in core technology roles today, you know, in sales roles, in finance roles, in leadership positions. So I wonder where the gap is, because 25 years ago, perhaps, you know, you were all fighting for maybe a handful of roles. That is not the case today, because the field has possibly been leveled a little bit. And so I know each of you are sort of, your approach to leadership is to say that not one person will be left behind. So you're sort of bringing everybody up along with you. But the question, just sort of long question, but the question that we've got from Yogesh is, one way to address lack of gender diversity is top leadership, at the top leadership is to hire. However, the ideal long-term solution is to groom women leaders within a time frame of 10 to 15 years. Mm-hmm. Are we doing anything on those lines? And I'd love for each of you to weigh in, perhaps starting with Jill.
Yeah, I mean, I think Yogesh, great question. And actually, I think you have to tackle both. So we have to go grassroots and encourage more females into the STEM subjects in schools and pull them then through the apprenticeships. And the interesting thing is, when you're looking at apprenticeships, and I had a team recently in a technical domain of payments, you know, very technical traditionally, and they brought in a group of apprentices, and they had a gender 50-50 split. That was not just that they wanted to create diversity, but they were able to market it in a really alternative way. So they had a whole bunch of people who thought about, well, what is attractive? Why are females not coming into this? What is stopping them? And so they were able to market it, because at the end of the day, there's some, you know, fantastic jobs in there, and they're attractive to all walks of society. So you need to get really smart and clever about how you're showing up into, you know, those recruitment campaigns. So we've got to definitely do a better job on that. And I'm seeing some experiments coming good on that. And then, of course, you've got to put more leaders at the top tables or the middle tables or the influential leadership teams. And I'm a real believer in creating space. Now, I remember when I again joined the bank probably, you know, 4 years ago, there was quite a technical area and there was a fantastic guy leading it. And he had three go-to men. It's very technical and very traditional. And they're all awesome. They're all fantastic guys. I mean, I think they still are today. They're amazing. But his leadership team is really diverse now. He has actually now got 8 direct reports. He doesn't have 3 go-to people. He has a breadth, and they are doing so much more. But that was not in his mind. He thought he couldn't live without just the 3. So broaden out and create space, and that will allow you to do so much more. Get closer to the work by broadening out. What an awesome way to actually create the space for more diversity. It is hard for people who are in it to think that they can do that, but see, when it happens, it's like, wow, it's a proper wow factor.
Thank you, Jill, for that insight. Lesley, can I ask for your sense of how do you think we could, and Kellogg's is, grooming women into leadership positions, creating that pipeline inside of the company?
Yeah, absolutely. Jill, I love that story about making space. I think it's a really great story. And I'm very aligned with the question, because, you know, one of the things that we can't change, maybe medical technology will change over the years, but at the moment, females have babies. Yeah, if a family is going to have a baby, it's got to be the female that carries it for 9 months and that takes however long they want to take off at the point then that they have the baby. If everything goes well, it might be a short period of time, but, you know, sometimes that's just not possible. So my theory is, unless we get to females before, this is a gross generalization because I know not all females have babies, but unless we get to females before they have babies and give them an understanding of their potential, their desire to return to a workplace, because to Stephanie's point, it's expensive. So why would I give up the whole of my salary on childcare to come back to a workplace if there isn't really a future career for me? If they know early on in their career that they've got potential, and whilst they may appear to be working for no actual monetary gain, they're still gaining experience and still, you know, staying in step with all of their peers. I think that's really, really important. And one of the ways that I do that in Kellogg is I have skip level sessions with across the whole of my organization. So, you know, right down to entry level interns, graduates that come on, and more junior people in our organization. And it's really, really important. And when we talk about our people and we talk about our talent, we don't just talk about our director level. We enable people to deep dive, and they say, oh my goodness, you know, I've got this new person in my team and they've got amazing potential. And we take the opportunity to get to know them. And then that comes back. I think it was it Jill or Bianca, maybe you, about talking about the social interactions. You know, females maybe not as able to make the social interactions. That's all about getting to know people on a human level. That's why that is a catalyst for people, I believe, for people getting ahead in their job. You get to know somebody on a human level, and, you know, you think, I know they can technically do their job, they're a great human being, absolutely, let's put them forward for that. So if we know who the talent is, who the people are to look out for pipeline of leaders moving forward, we can find lots of different ways of getting to know our people at that human level without it being a game of golf or drinks in the pub after work. So there's some of the things that I think absolutely will change change the pipeline, change the playing field moving forward that is directly in our control. Because if we, you know, if we four on this call don't make change happen, nobody else is going to do it. So we're in control of that. We can make that happen.
Absolutely. I know we're up on time, but I definitely want to hear Stephanie's view on this, because there are a whole bunch of questions that have come in on this very specific subject. For example, can I request our panelists to present a perspective on how their organizations are moving barriers of entry to their organization? So you've just heard what Lloyds is doing and what Kellogg's is doing. And Stephanie, give us a view of Wipro, and I'm happy to sort of layer on some of the longer running programs that have been useful for women in Wipro.
Yeah, my goal right now is to, as I start to evaluate our sales teams and our client-facing teams, and certainly the organization that I'm building, you know, how do we create opportunities for diversity for women and for the LGBTQ community and for, underrepresented ethnicities at Wipro? Because it's pretty heavily dominated by Indian heritage leaders, and which is, so we have a lot of work to do, but I do think that, it has to be purposeful. And I think, this next generation of millennials and Zs are, branding, creating their brand is something they're all doing through social media, and they've grown up in a globalized world. And so I think eventually it's going to happen because they don't know any other way. And they're already doing those things at such a young age. So I think they're going to take care of this problem over the next 2 to 3 generations. I think our job collectively as more senior women in leadership is to accelerate that impact. And so what can we do now to help accelerate that? And I think part of it is recognizing, to what Lesley said, very early in their career, the traits I exhibited at 25 and 28 before I ever had children are very similar to the traits I exhibit now. I've learned, I've grown, I've matured, but I had that potential then, and people saw it in me, and I have it now. And so I think we have to look at our younger generations and recognize their skill sets and their potential early, give them ways to develop that, even if they're on maternity leave or taking a break. And then accelerate that when they fully engage back in the workforce. So I think I had a woman cry one time to me because she said, I don't think I should have a baby right now. I'm up for promotion. And I'm like, no, don't make those choices. In 30 years, that baby is going to be what matters, not that promotion. And so she did. But I think we have to be supportive to Lesley's point of women early in their careers at those very decisive moments when they're making the choices to have families, follow their partner or spouse in their career, and make it conscious decisions for themselves and be able to see past the moment and look 10 years down the road. So that's my commitment as I start to look at how we impact diversity at Wipro.
Absolutely. And to your point about, those who are on a break, whether it is for, child caring or elder care or studies, Wipro has a Begin Again program, which is a second career program for women who are looking to restart their careers, whether it is, after they've taken a year off to study or, to look after family, et cetera. Plus, I think what has really worked in Wipro, for all those questions which have come in about how are we ensuring that women stay within the roles after we've hired them, is that we've got a very successful and a very life stage-wise structured and unique approach to female talent, which is customized to cater to their specific needs in the different times in their life, right? So whether it is, flexibility, whether it is exposure, whether it is discovery, whether it's mentorship, et cetera. So that approach female talent has really sort of worked for us. Now, I have so many questions, and I know I cannot take all of them. And I do want to need to have to wrap this up right now, but I do want to say that to everybody who has asked if this conversation is going to be available later on, because some are having streaming issues, et cetera, absolutely, this conversation is going to be available on Wipro's Women in Business website. You can go look it up in another couple of days. It should be up. We'll be also sharing this on social media. If you have a comment, feel free to write into us. All the leaders that you see here on the panel, they're active on LinkedIn, on Twitter, so feel free to write to them. And to all of you, all three of you, Stephanie, Lesley, Jill, thank you for your time. Thank you for those insights, right? So for me, the takeaway is that, you know, make space for people. Experiment to understand what is that right level of flexibility and choice that you're creating for people. And as women, no matter what stage of your life you're in, really learn to say no. And, you know, learn to find that balance and prioritize your well-being and your family. And it's really that balance at that stage in your life. So thank you very much for your time. We're 5 minutes over, so I'm going to wrap this up. And I hope that we can continue this discussion and move from dialogue to action soon. Thank you.